Hey, it's Martavis Bryant, a.k.a. Martin McBride.
Hey, this is Fred Jackson.
This is Hall of Famer Marshall Faulk.
Hey, this is Allen Robinson.
Hey, this is Amir Abdullah.
Hey, this is Willie Snead.
Hey, this is David Johnson.
Hey, yeah, this is Christian Michael.
Hi, this is Eric Dixon, NFL Hall of Famer, and you're listening to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast, coming to you from the FantasyJocks.com studios with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Whoa, 2 days away from the NFL draft.
Me and Jay are doing the draft dance right now.
2 days, my friends.
2 days.
You know what that is? 2 days. That's Jason's 40 time. 2 days.
2 days.
2 days away from the NFL draft.
As we call it in my household, two sleeps.
Two sleeps.
When you're talking to the kids, like, when is this happening? Two sleeps. They don't get the concept yet of the days.
There's something entertaining about the
you don't like go the, with the sleep measurements?
The childlike anticipation for the NFL draft that comes with two sleeps away from the draft.
We're two sleeps away.
All right.
Not if I skip one.
Right. I guess that's a fair point.
I'd be trying to just sleep the full 2 days. So you just time travel.
One sleep away then.
Tuesday, April 25th. We're back again. The Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Look, the draft is almost here. The final shoe to drop, so to speak, of the offseason. That's when things really get fired up, ready to go for 2017, when your draft plans as a fantasy football owner can begin to take shape. You know, no more question marks. I mean, you're going to have some second-tier free agent signings. You're going to have the Jamal Charles and Adrian Peterson and those type of players.
You do have camp battles to still
you
shape
do.
Things
you
out.
You do. And we'll keep you up to date with everything that's going on all offseason. That's what we do here. We're a year-round fantasy football podcast, but I'm excited for the draft. I think we all are excited. And today's show is jam-packed with draft info. We're going to be breaking down the rookies. It's going to be a great episode. We're going to go through all the positions. This is about name recognition.
Yeah.
This is about knowing what to watch for
get
on
hyped.
Draft day. Get hyped up. And then Thursday before the draft, we're going to give you some team overviews so you can be anticipating, looking forward to some of the better fits.
I believe
right?
on Thursday we are going to be making our predictions for the major
guys.
And where they'll go.
It's round one, correct?
Sure. We'll figure that out between now and Thursday. But
don't box us in, Mike.
After the draft, we're going to calculate up who got the most right. And whoever got the most right picks the lunch of whoever got the most wrong. Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Is that what it, so the middle person is
middle person
is
safe.
All right. Just got to be better than the last place.
Yeah. Well, then someone's going to be a loser.
Someone's eating eggplant.
And what? We'll talk about that on the show the following week, our draft recap shows.
Of course.
So, all right. I've got a very essential quick question of the day. You know, these quick questions, they hit hard. They're very serious. What's the most essential draft food?
Mm.
What food do you need? We get a disproportionate amount of questions about what do you need for the NFL draft food-wise, because this is crucial.
You got to have your friends over. You have that draft day party. What do you give them to eat?
Mm-hmm. Now, Mike, you should probably bring it up again.
You have to. It's the legendary dip. It is. I mean, this thing has become just historically famous now across the nation because people are understanding that this is not only an easy to create food item that you can bring,
but necessary.
It is necessary. It is delicious.
So this you've got a dip. Mike has a dip.
It is incredible. It's a sausage dip, and for all the culinary impaired out there, let me help you out. This is all you need. You need one block of Philly cream cheese. You need one can of Rotel mild and a half or to a full pound. I mean, it depends on how meaty you like the dip, but I go with a half pound of the sweet Italian sausage. You brown the sausage, and you throw it all in a crock pot, and you're done.
Chop it up and throw it in a crock pot. Yeah.
That is as easy as rolling David Johnson into your lineup every week.
And if you've never seen it, I will admit that perhaps at first glance you go, well, that's it's a little strange looking, But just get those dip chips ready, and your draft will be changed forever.
For me, I'm going to go pizza. Look, if you're having a draft party.
Over wings?
Yes. I thought about that. I was thinking, what's more important? But you got to have the pizza because you need to be able to go, run, grab a slice, come back, you know, in between the picks, at commercials. I don't want my hands
One
up.
Slice per pick.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
A lot of pizza.
That's the correct answer, Jason.
Oh, Brooks weighing in. He's the pizza lover.
I'll probably have a pint of Halo Top in my new Halo Top holsters. Yeah. I've got an actual leather holster where I can
put spoons in the belt.
Where I can whoosh.
Just imagining you with spoons.
I would. It's a spoon on the right, and then the actual pints on the left. But it's refrigerated, like it's a big holster.
Also then imagining you with the typical hat that holds the two beverages.
Oh yeah,
except
just root beer.
No, it's Halo Top that he has like blended into a shake.
Yeah, well, I do like my ice cream. All right, we're gonna talk some news that just broke yesterday.
News and notes from around the league.
Last Thursday, not yesterday.
Oh, is that why Jason was looking around So we're pre-recording this show because Mike has a family vacation.
Got to get ready
taking
for the draft.
Place on Tuesday, so we're recording this Friday. So if Marshawn Lynch, for instance, were to sign,
that's an excellent point.
If he were to sign, I would obviously have spent most of this show mocking Mike.
Correct.
So don't come in here with expectations that I've let you down because
it's always Thursday.
There's always Thursday. All right, the NFL schedule was released. I hopped on to jointhefoot.com last night, was chatting with members of the Foot Clan, and they were asking, do we have some thoughts or feedback on the NFL schedule? We know that the season starts with New England and Alex Smith.
Oh, of course.
Kansas City. I believe Alex Smith has the most primetime games of anybody.
What?
And that is not a joke. So my guess is that the NFL is monitoring Twitter for buzz, and the Alex Smith has been, they're like, the world loves Alex Smith.
He's must-watch TV.
So,
in a world where people are throwing for 400 yards a game, Alex Smith is burning it up with 180.
I was just going to say, when you talk strength of schedule, because that's the first thing that comes out, like the Colts, they have the easiest strength of schedule in the league. You have some good schedules for the Jacksonville. Cardinals have a pretty good one, 23rd, I think. You have to keep in mind, like, that is to us many times a tie-breaking type of fantasy decision, is the strength of schedule. Strength of schedule is based on last year. I mean, you don't know what this year's strength of schedule will be, say the word.
Yeah, you'll hear us talk about a lot in the draft that we don't factor too much, the strength of schedule early in the season. Once we've got enough data of 2017, so, when we get halfway through the year, those matchups really start to matter, because when you compare year over year defenses and where they rank, I mean, just look at the New York Giants last year, right? I mean, one of the best passing defenses in the league the year before. They were one of the worst.
Yes.
So if you went into that year and you said, hey, I've got a home game against the Giants. Oh, that's going to be juicy. Well, you were probably wrong.
Well, and I think you actually make a point within your point.
Yes.
A pointception, if you will.
I did it.
But here's what you said there, is that you differentiated between strength of schedule and passing and running defenses. Those are the things that actually maybe even greatlier.
Oh, yes. Yes. Come to me.
You will turn to the dark side, man.
What are
Oh gosh!
Let's talk about that.
Now I know what it feels like to be Jason and be making a wonderful point and have it completely destroyed by one word that slips out of your mouth.
I will take it over then.
Good.
Shout out. It's still early, and a lot of places need to run their data and see. But if you do want to look back at the 2016 and project that forward, at Sharp Football, shout out, great Twitter follow.
It's very sharp.
Very sharp. Has some really good work on this, and he's broken it down pass D, run D, their efficiency, and he's got like this blend of certain stats that is really smart, is really sharp, one might say. And if you look at that for this upcoming season, and you look at their blended pass D schedule, you've got the league ranked kind of like who's got the best, who's got the worst on this chart, and a mile away in first place, like totally off the chart
for
easiest schedule is the Carolina Panthers against the pass D. So maybe
you're welcome,
Kelvin,
Cam Newton.
Kelvin Benjamin might be able to succeed a little bit more.
More than two games?
Yeah.
That was it.
The guy throwing him the ball has to succeed too. All right, let's jump right into the rookie preview. We got a lot of names to get you aware of out there. And so let's go ahead and start at the running back position.
Running backs.
All right. This is the hotness right now. This is what people want to know about. This rookie class has been much hyped for years. I'm not sure that's now that we're here that everyone's as hyped, but there are still some really heavy hitters here who, and with the success of Ezekiel Elliott kind of transforming things, then, I mean, there could be more than just one guy taken in the first round.
There's no way that the success of Ezekiel Elliott didn't affect the way dynasty rookie draft owners are looking at this draft and trading for those top picks. I think that had an impact that pushed people towards running backs, that pushed people towards, wow, I could get a guy that not only is great long term, but could be a top five type of player immediately. And so generally, you don't get an Ezekiel Elliott every year.
No, you certainly do not.
Is that in the cards this year for anybody? And who's your favorite running back right now? What's the name that you think is going to end up on top?
If you're comparing it to Elliott, like, in my opinion, abandon hope on that, because Ezekiel Elliott was a dominant college running back. He was great in all facets of the game, extremely well-rounded, despite them not really using him in pass catching last year for Dallas, and obviously he showed that he's got the chops. But it was the perfect rookie candidate, went to the absolute ideal situation, and that doesn't exist this year. I think that the best fantasy situation would be if somehow a three-down guy went to Oakland and took over. But we're going to talk about that stuff on Thursday. My favorite higher-level guy of this draft that I'm most interested in is, I really like Christian McCaffrey. I think that he is an all-around guy. He was absolutely dominant at the college level, and what I love on top of him, I mean, he had a year with 2,000 yards rushing, so it's not like he can't get it done on the ground. But in the receiving game, absolutely incredible. A year with 45 receptions, 37 receptions. I know it's become a little bit in vogue to like Christian McCaffrey, but I don't see why that's a bad thing to do. I think that this group who likes him, I'm on board with that. He's the most interesting name for the first round for me.
Well, he's certainly the most well-rounded, without a doubt. There's nobody who can, you know, run up the middle, run to the side, can run out of shotgun, can run out of, the I formation.
Blew up the combine.
Can catch the ball as well, can play on special teams. I mean, he could be a wide receiver. He can. There's no better, more well-rounded player in this year's draft. And really, you know, when you're just talking about well-rounded, he's even more well-rounded than Zeke, but he is not as special or as built for the workload. And that's my worry, I will say, with Christian McCaffrey. In half-point and full-point PPR leagues, you're going to get a bonus from him, because any team drafting him is going to use him in the passing game. His hands, I mean, when he catches the ball, it's like a wide receiver, just effortless, thoughtless, just the ball sticks to him and he moves. The problem that I have is that just because we draft Knicks watch the game tape and argue that he can run it up the middle and he can get 20 carries a game, we can scream all day that can happen and be frustrated the coach isn't doing it. But it doesn't change the fact that coaches might not want to give that workload to a guy, you know, that's not 220 pounds.
And he could easily end up in a situation where he is he's not going to walk in and take three downs someplace. You know, he could go to a Denver and end up sharing time with C.J. Anderson and with Booker. Now, he's 20 years old. He's 2 years younger than Leonard Fournette. Fournette and Dalvin Cook are the other two big names in the first round. I love Leonard Fournette as a game-changing type of running back that Look, what did Adrian Peterson show people? And I'm not saying Leonard Fournette is Adrian Peterson, but what he showed people were these big monster week-winning fantasy football plays, and the speed and size combination of Leonard Fournette tells me you're going to get some of those in year one, regardless of landing spot, regardless of volume. Now, I think a team that's drafting him is going to take him in the top 10, 15 picks at worst. So that's going to necessitate, by draft position, a high volume and workload for Leonard Fournette. I think he's got the body and the size to sustain an NFL workload. It's why he's at the top of my board. I respect the fantasy realities of a guy like Dalvin Cook and Christian McCaffrey to be instantaneously involved in the passing game. And so it's very possible these guys are all competing for the fantasy crown, so to speak, as rookies. But Fournette's the big guy for me, literally, figuratively.
Gigantic.
I just love everything about him. We don't see a usage in the passing game in college. It doesn't mean it cannot happen, but the likelihood of that happening is lower.
Yeah, what we have seen from him, pass skills wise, is that he can do the job. He's not the same as a Christian McCaffrey. I'm not.
Wouldn't
saying
you say Gurley
excellent.
Can do the job, but he's not. He doesn't excel at it. Isn't that the same type of thing?
I feel like we had data on him just watching him in college. He was used. That's why it was Gurley was so bizarre his rookie year that Jeff Fisher was not dialing up plays to throw to his best player.
Well, I was just kind of – I thought I was adding to your point.
No, I actually do. I think that you make a very good analogy. I would say they both are in the same realm of when it comes to being capable of catching the ball – they're both capable. That's not their strength.
Not necessarily featured.
Right.
Gurley had a 37 reception year his sophomore year.
Okay.
Which is all right. And so, you know.
That's exactly what McCaffrey had last year.
For Leonard Fournette.
It's better than all right.
But. For Leonard Fournette, I would be surprised, and we don't know where he's drafted yet, but even now I can say I will be surprised if he doesn't get 250 carries. I mean, you're getting a guy to build an offense around. And the thing that I like about him the most, more than metrics, more than, you know, the fact that his weight adjusted speed score is unbelievable, is that from high school, probably even from grade school, this guy was talked about as one of those generational type of players. And he did it.
His kindergarten scouting was great.
And he came in as, you know, the top recruit into college. And all he did in college was crush college players and show that he was one of the most dominant college running backs. When you've got a guy that's just done that his whole life, has never slowed down, and now, you know, the NFL circles love this guy. And if he's drafted high, I don't see a reason why, you know, we want to look at film and find all the flaws in guys, and there's certain things he can't do. Personally, when I watch it, and some people disagree, I genuinely think he struggles and is not special at a shotgun. That's just what I see on film. That's what I think the numbers back up. I'm not saying he forgets how to run, but that's not his specialty. But he is going to be drafted, made the centerpiece of an offense, given the ball, and I think he's going to crush it. So, I'm with you, Andy. He is my number one running back for sure in this class. And I love McCaffrey as well.
Sure.
So that leaves Dalvin Cook.
Dalvin Cook has a few off-the-field potential concerns, baggage that comes along with him. He's also 5'10", 210, undersized, but a weapon in all facets. I mean, he was obviously a very dominant player. You put him in a wide-open type of offense. You put him in a position where I keep saying Philadelphia. I know we're going to talk about fits. I think that's a great fit for Dalvin Cook. But I do think that there's the potential for Dalvin Cook to drop in this draft.
Certainly.
Because if the match isn't there for Dalvin Cook with the teams on the board, I think he's the kind of guy that could slide in this draft for sure. So,
and he, if you were not paying attention, which if you're listening to a fantasy football podcast in April, you probably were, Dalvin Cook quickly fell down people's draft boards for dynasty drafts when he sucked off the combine. I mean, his numbers were startling. When you watch him on tape, it just did not match with what he was able to produce at the combine for athletic measurables.
You know what's funny is
Why don't they run the 40 with pads? Why isn't that like another metric?
They shouldn't even run it without pads. Like, they should just change it over to get in your, you know, your football. Grab the football.
Get in your football?
Like
your
Cinderella? Football climb
like
into
Cinderella.
The
I took the football to the ball.
You know, get in your uniform and run. I mean, that's
how you play, right?
If you're a running back, you should have the ball in your hands.
It is sure.
And run. But, anyways, you know, Dalvin Cook, to me, and I'm not going to be popular for saying this.
Uh-oh.
You know, I don't see – when I watch his highlights, the dude is electric. He has so many breakaway plays and clearly is fast. I mean, and that he didn't have a problem with at the combine. I think he ran, what, a 4.49? But he did not look to me like a guy that I could trust in the NFL for a lead back. He had fumbling issues.
He did not get the short yardage. He bounces it outside too much. I agree with all that.
He was really bad at pass protection when I was watching. The games that I watched every snap of, you know, I would see him whiff on guys or just get beat, or it looked like he didn't know how to do it. And, you know, he's only 210 pounds, which, you know, that's fine. It's not into the world. But I'm saying, to invest a first-round draft pick in a guy that has these off-field baggage, fumbles, pass protection, I would be
just
surprised.
Just a sentiment here from two-thirds of the fantasy footballers, at least.
Sure, and I still really like him. I agree. I don't think he's a first-round draft pick, right, but I still like him.
All right, some more names in the running back position to throw out there. Before I do that, I want to thank Pristine Auction for supporting the show, supporting the podcast. Look, you hear us talk about them right now.
Supporting your living rooms.
Oh, dude. I mean, Dak Prescott lit the league on fire. Tons of autographed Dak Prescott gear on pristineauction.com. Went on there this morning. Hundreds of daily auctions. There's a Derek Carr autographed jersey sitting on the homepage. There's a if you want to go big time with your celebration of the Patriots Super Bowl, there's a 2016 Patriots autographed helmet, everybody on the team. Right on the homepage. And if you just, you know, if you're just a Tom Brady loyalist, you can get that helmet, or you can get the Tom Brady signed helmet, or you can get the Tom Brady signed Michigan helmet that's sitting on the homepage. There's some Joe Montana gear that went up there for the classic football lovers. Hundreds of daily auctions, completely free to check it out. PristineAuction.com, PRISTINE auction.com. You sign up for a free account so you can browse the auctions.
You let them know the footballer sent you.
We sent you. It's us. We sent you. All right, Joe Mixon.
Oh, boy.
You got to talk about it. And, yes, you have to address the off-field issues. They are there. And so just to get it out of the way real quickly, there are a lot of people who play fantasy football who, I mean, you saw this with Adrian Peterson's incident. If you want to play and you say, these guys, no, they don't go on my team, that is completely fine. I personally do not have a problem with that, but we have to give you the analysis of what this guy is going to do in the NFL.
Yeah, and the reality is he would be my number one running back if it wasn't for the incident. And that's not because of just a moralistic thing. It's because that incident still affects his NFL trajectory, and you can't ignore that. The fact that he's going to cost less draft capital for a team is not going to be as invested in them. A team might make him prove himself over a longer period of time before they say, hey, you're the center of our offense or our franchise. When it comes to him as a talent, as a player, it had been a while since I had watched Joe Mixon. He was one of the first guys, and I was watching Samaje Perine, a teammate who, Mike, I know you
like.
Yeah,
we'll talk about him.
And he was all right to me. And then I flipped over and watched the same game to Mixon and was like, oh, my goodness, dude. This guy, his vision is perfect. His cuts are electric. His speed is unbelievable. His size is great. He catches the ball almost as well as McCaffrey. I don't have anything on the field I don't like about Mixon.
And there's a potential that he's not drafted.
True.
Or yeah, isn't drafted until the 6th, 7th, 8th round.
He could go anywhere
when a
from
team
the second.
Can justify the risk associated with Joe Mixon. And like you said, there are teams, without question, that have taken him off the board. I mean, and there was other reports. They were erroneous, supposedly erroneous. We don't know. Other reports of incidents involving Joe Mixon. And here's the thing. You don't want to draft a player who even can be, you know, accused of something, even if it's false. You put yourself in a position where you are not above reproach as an athlete. Those things come to light the same way they do for presidential candidates. You know, the media out there wants a story. If you've put yourself in that position, you can be a distraction for your team. And some teams do not want to take any chance at that distraction. Or some teams basically say a distraction is worth no more than an eighth round pick, because at least at that point we can cut that guy if they become, you know, you haven't invested the capital that would make it impossible for you to, in a PR situation, cut the guy. So I need to throw more names out there. We got to jump into the wide receivers here soon. Alvin Kamara out of Tennessee.
We'll pause on him real quick because there is actual first round buzz on him.
I've seen him go in some first round mocks.
I don't get it. Okay, sure. I get it as far as the athleticism, but the sample size, you have 2 years of him as a sophomore and a junior, 107 attempts, 103 rushing attempts, great in the passing game. And when you watch him, he is a special talent. For when I'm scouting him, it was essentially, though it's an all or nothing thing for him on what I would see. It was if he gets met with contact at the line of scrimmage, it's done. The play is over. But if he is moving with any kind of force, or, you know, just 3 yards down the field catching a pass, that dude is going to give the slippery fish a run for his money.
Yeah, I'll just say this really quickly on him, that a lot of people I respect don't like him, don't like his film. I was surprised when I watched him. I went in with kind of a negative view already, and I really liked everything I saw. You know, when I watch him and I watch Dalvin Cook, just film, just, you know, what are they making happen? I see very, very similar players. The difference is that I don't think Kamara is going to be I see the first round, but he could end up being just a satellite back in the NFL, not used as much as a rusher because of that volume.
Deontay Foreman out of Texas and Samaje Perine, previously mentioned, out of Oklahoma. Both of those guys are on a lot of day two boards. What do you think of Deontay Foreman and Samaje Perine and how they project to the NFL and for fantasy football?
What's funny is this is where these are lower level guys, but this is a split here of Jason loves Foreman.
I do.
Foreman. You don't have to be
sorry.
But I sorry.
Do. There's reasons that I do have to be sorry.
And I love what I've seen from Samaje Perine. I'm going to let Jason go first here and talk about Foreman.
Sure. Deontay Foreman, when I watch him, I think he is an athletic freak. He looks like he can take a full workload in the NFL. His actual production is historically great. And you can say, for whatever reason, maybe they don't stack the box enough. Maybe it's a product of the system. But other guys who don't get the box stacked and have come in that same system haven't done what Deontay Foreman has done.
323 attempts, 2,028 yards, and 15 touchdowns in his 2016 season.
His box score, if you're looking back at what he did, is actually to the point where it is comical, because every single game of 2016, he is well over 100 yards. And you've never seen.
Well, Jay Ajayi comes to mind when you look at a collegiate box score that just jumped off the page.
You're like, this is not real now.
Six foot, 233. He's a bigger back. That adds to what Jason said about sustaining NFL workload. Just depends on that team that grabs.
That's all I saw when I watched was and I realized he doesn't catch the ball, and Jay Ajayi did in college. And he's got a fumbling
problem. So
he doesn't
necessarily hold on to the ball.
Yeah. So there are. That's why I say I'm sorry. There are reasons to not like him, but I do think that he has the body to be an NFL back. And
I was starting to picture a guy that actually he chooses not to catch the ball, so they just keeps his arms down at his side and it just bounces off his chest.
It's
like
almost,
I will not do it. No.
And it's then almost
he
goes, like
but
that.
No.
No, it's almost like that. When you watch his film, every play is a shotgun snap, and they either hand it to him or they fake the ball to him, and then he runs forward and he never turns around. He's not looking for a pass. He'll just go out.
So,
and he'll,
so bruiser goal line.
Don't throw
bruiser
me.
Goal
don't throw
line
me.
Candidate. Samaje Perine, give me the scoop.
It's a similar situation here. For these are bruiser, you know, first and second down guys.
Both over 230.
While Perine, I think he can stay on the field because there's not a lot of if you're looking at what he's done in the production, but he can catch the ball. I feel like he has soft enough hands, and he's solid in pass protection. But what stands out for me for Samaje Perine Bots, that's what I'm calling him. I'm calling him the Perine Bot because he brings it. Watch him just mow people over. But it's his balance. He has Marshawn Lynch-esque balance, where once he gets going, he is able to absorb hits and continue to move forward. And it's when I was watching all these guys, that's, I hadn't seen anyone with that balance.
Any
yet.
Concern with collegiate production decreasing each of his last 3 years, both in touchdown and total yardage?
I mean, it would 2014, that he was at Oklahoma. That was the year Mixon was suspended. So he was, you know, more of the main guy. And then in 2016, he's coming back from an injury. He was a bit, you can see it. He's a little more sluggish. So that's possibly a negative on
him. And then you've got the mix and combo in 2016.
In 2016, his tape is not as special to me. But he's one of these guys that my dream is him going to Oakland. I'm jumping ahead to Thursday's show. But
No, it's fine. I mentioned a few. Look, I'm going to just drop some names out there that you're going to hear. Kareem Hunt, Jeremy McNichols, Jamal Williams, who I know Mike really likes.
Yeah, Jamal Williams, sidestepper.
We've got to get on to the wide receivers.
Frank Sinatra.
So let's do that right now. Wide receivers, bringing in NFL's Matt Harmon.
Wide receivers.
The fantasy footballers are very excited to bring a guest on. It's been quite a while since we've had a guest on the show, and what better way to break that ice than bring on Matt Harmon from thenfl.com. How are you doing today, Mr. Harmon?
I'm good, fellas. It's good to be talking to you guys. You know, the draft is is it like 10 days away now or something like that? I don't know, but it's approaching fast, and I'm ready. I'm ready now at this point to just see what all unfolds, and especially where these wide receivers land, and then really get the takes going about what they might be doing in year one or even down the line for dynasty leagues.
Through the power of recording, the draft may or may not be in like 2 days, depending on what people are hearing this. So we'll figure all that out. But of course, if you've been listening to the show, you know that we have partnered with Matt Harmer, who is the developer, the mad scientist behind Reception Perception, an excellent way to look at how successful a wide receiver can actually be apart from a quarterback. So Harmon, why don't you give people just the brief cliff notes of what Reception Perception is all about?
Yeah, so if any listeners are new to what Reception Perception is, or has especially been hearing you guys talk about it for the last few months, what Reception Perception is it's essentially, like Mike just said, it's a way to try to separate wide receiver play from other variables, because I mean the wide receiver is just inherently dependent on other things for their production to accumulate, whether it be the quarterback, the quality of the throw, the quality of the protection, the target actually designed to go their way, or the quarterback choosing to do that. So a lot of other metrics to evaluate wide receiver play is really noisy because it welcomes a lot of other variables in. What Reception Perception is I just look at a wide receiver, every single route that they run over a 6-game sample for NFL players, six-game sample for college prospects, 8 games for NFL players, because that's where I've seen the data normalize, and essentially just chart how often they got open on each route, what routes they run most often, and essentially how often they get open against man, zone, press coverage, as well as some ancillary metrics like contested catch conversion rate.
And of course, you can check out a bunch of these guys broken down on the fantasyfootballers.com. Matt's done an excellent job with them. And of course, in the Ultimate Draft Kit, he's going to be breaking down the pros exclusively available inside the draft kit. So let's get started at the top. Matt, we got Corey Davis is kind of heralded as the number one guy on the board. Smaller school, but it looks to be the part. Is Corey Davis still your number one guy?
He is still my number one guy. And the interesting part about Corey Davis's evaluation is that he hasn't done anything in the pre-draft process. You know, he essentially had an injury that was going to put him out of the combine, put him out of the Senior Bowl, and he's been out of sight and out of mind for a long time, and you're already starting to see the whispers now of whether NFL teams are going to be able to stomach that, especially without getting raw athletic numbers because of his inability to test and the fact that he comes from a small conference. But you look at his reception perception, he really smashed that low level of competition with the 79.3% success rate versus man coverage. That's a top three score of the last two draft classes that I've charted, the 94th percentile. It was also really successful against press coverage, and his route tree shows he can separate all over the field, deep, intermediate, and short. I kind of liken him to like a Sammy Watkins type player, which I think should get people excited. It also just kind of
two or three games a year type of.
So now we know why he has missed so much in the off season.
Yeah, actually, now that you make that point, now that I'm saying that, I've never thought about
it's
that
a really
way.
Really good comp.
Right, when I juxtapose those two things together, it makes a lot of sense now. But yeah, no, I think that the way Watkins separates is maybe not the most dominant, like, physical big receiver. I think Corey Davis is that way, even though he is listed, I think, a few pounds heavier and a few inches taller.
What is his best attribute? Coming to the NFL, Corey Davis, you think, you know, he's going to excel because of what?
So I think the fact that he's really solid at everything is a pretty good thing, is a pretty good way to sell it. Like, I think he has a really safe floor. But if you want to talk about his most impressive trait, I think it's that he's great after the catch. So he's a type of player that you could see run a lot of like slants or screens. I think that's why a lot of people compare him to like a Demaryius Thomas level player, although I don't like that comparison just because of how dominant DT is after the catch. I think Corey Davis can be that type of player in the NFL.
Let's move on to the man with the fast feet, the burner, the absolute burner, broke the record at the NFL Combine for the 40-yard dash. Mr. John Ross, will he translate? Because he's a little bit smaller, but can he translate to the pros?
Yeah, it's funny, like you say, he broke the record. And I think
that's
it's
what
almost
people think about him, is that he's just really fast.
And I honestly, I think that's what we should think about him, because if you, it's almost like at this point, it's been so long since we've seen him break the record that it's like, yeah, John Ross broke the record. He's a fast player at the combine, but what else can he do? And it's like, well, that's really pretty cool. Like, he's the fastest player ever. I think that it's almost like you can't really undersell that. You know what I mean? But if you do want to look beyond just the all world speed, in his reception perception, he did show well. Again, he was above the two-year prospect average at beating man, zone, and press coverage. You see him run a lot of deep routes, of course, but you look at like the out routes, the dig routes, the curl, the comeback. Those are all routes that he grades out above the prospect average at creating separation. Some impressive scores there. And I think that speaks to, yeah, he gets a lot of cushion from, you know, Pac-12 defenders because of his speed. And, you know, he's not going to necessarily get that same sort of treatment at the NFL level, although he will get a lot of respect because of his speed. I think that also shows you he can sell that vertical route really well and then break off, you know, into the intermediate zone or the short zones and really pick up chunk yardage that way. So I kind of liken him more to a T.Y. Hilton level deep threat. Like, he can go along that higher end of the archetype more than the Will Fuller or Ted Ginn version of that small speed receiver archetype.
So you see him as a better prospect than Will Fuller, who was fast coming out last year?
Without a doubt, Jason, no question in my mind. If you look at their reception perceptions last year, one of Will Fuller's weakest points was his success rate versus press coverage. And John Ross is obviously smaller too, but I think a lot of times we just kind of internalize and like extrapolate size to things that, you know, a skill like a contested catch rate or a success rate versus press coverage. But technique comes into a lot of it too. And I think Ross shows much more of a balanced game than Fuller. The biggest question with Ross is injuries. And that's something that's a big elephant in the room, that just like the speed can't be undersold either. Ross has had a lot of injury problems. He's also had offseason surgery this year. He could easily become a what could have been player based on those injuries. But, you know, that's hard for me to measure.
Do you view him as a player that is going to succeed better with a big one on the outside wherever he lands? Like, is he a player that, you know, because of his size and because of the nature of what he does, do you feel like he can come in and, you know, Will Fuller came in, ran out of the slot a bunch last year. What is John Ross going to do? Is it going to be successful with a big guy outside, or is he going to be able to come in and kind of own an offense?
These players typically don't ever become target hogs and offenses, you know. See, like I mentioned, T.Y. Hilton, I think he could be that player because Hilton has developed that far down the small receiver, small speed receiver archetype. It just would, I mean, I don't want to cop out of the question, but it would just depend on how he develops as a pro. I can easily see, though, Ross being a much better real-life NFL receiver and helpful to his football team than he's helpful to fantasy owners, though. So that's a whole separate conversation, but I can easily see that being the case.
The Offspring, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the band The Offspring. Well, they had a hit track. It wasn't really a hit track, but they had a song called...
But Mike knew it. But it was a song Mike knew.
It was a song called Cool to Hate, and this next guy reminds me of that, Mike Williams, because lately it feels like it's become very cool to hate Mike Williams. So what's your temperature on him?
So you guys know I kind of detest ranking things. That's one of the things I don't like to do. Although I did start ranking these players for our Fantasy Hipsters podcast. Download on iTunes, leave a 5-star rating.
Nicely done.
So I did do that there. And I put Williams as my wide receiver 4, which I don't know if that's slanderous or whatever, but there's just another prospect that we haven't talked about that I like better than him that I'm sure we'll get into later. And if you look at Williams, though, you're right. It has become trendy to hate him. A lot of players, I wrote about this in the reception perception articles on your guys' site, that the thing with Williams is you see him making a lot of contested catches on, you know, draft breakdown cutups or when you're watching games of him from the broadcast angle. And that's true. He's great on contested catches, 81% conversion rate for me. That's a top 5 score over the last 2 years. I think then people tend to extrapolate to those players. Well, he must, you know, not get a lot of separation because he's always making those contested catches. But that's generally just a trick that your brain plays on you and fills in the information. So for me, for these players, because I get to watch them on an All-22 film and I get to chart all their routes, excuse me if that is a humble brag, but, you know, just whatever. For Williams, like I kind of look for those players to just separate well enough. And Williams graded out at the 55th percentile for success rate versus man coverage. So I think that's much like an Alshon Jeffrey type of player who also is an NFL player, doesn't have dominant success rates against coverage, but they're just above the league average. So I think he can separate well enough. You know, my buddy Matt Waldman kind of compares him to a Dwayne Bowe type of player, and that might give people fits.
Yeah, it's going to freak people out.
Dwayne Bowe had one great year.
Yeah, I mean, when Dwayne Bowe, you know, maybe he's Dwayne Bowe without the concerns about whether he's just going to kind of take years off in his career. But I think stylistically, they're pretty similar in like guys that can definitely make plays the ball in the air. And then one of Bowe's really good years with the Andy Reid Chiefs was when they got him on slant routes a lot. And that's one of Williams, outside of just vertical routes where he can post up defenders down the field, you see him have high success rates on slants and post routes. So I think that's kind of actually pretty encouraging for his NFL prospects.
I feel like this year Mike Williams is last year's Tyler Boyd, in the sense that I know I like Tyler Boyd a lot more than you did last year, Harmon. This year I like Mike Williams, but
fight.
But you're a Chris Godwin guy, right? Is he the reason that Mike Williams is number 4?
I am, and just to circle back to the Tyler Boyd thing too, there's another player in this draft that I feel very, very similar to how I feel about Tyler Boyd last year, but we can touch on that later. But yes, Chris Godwin this year is one of my guys. I have him as my wide receiver 3 in this draft class above Mike Williams, because when you look at Chris Godwin, he came out with the top score on contested catches for me over the last 2 draft classes at 85.7%, narrowly beating out Josh Doxton from 2016, who we know had one of the best, was just really good at winning the ball in the air. So with Godwin beating out Williams, at least being Williams equal or better on contested catches, it's then when you go into a success rate versus coverage scores that Godwin really shows out with a 73.5% success rate versus man coverage. That's at the 76th percentile over the last 2 years. Above average against press, above average against zone coverage. Really, his separation scores, he has above average separation scores on all routes except the straight go route. So to me, he also smashed the combine. He's really done himself some favors in the pre-draft process. I love Chris Godwin. I think he's a complete player. He does everything well. And he's one of my favorite wide receivers in this class.
Do you got Chris Godwin as a sneaky day 1 guy, or is he most likely to fall to day 2 or a little bit lower?
So when we started, the funny thing is like when we started this process, back before, you know, the combine or the Senior Bowl or anything, when I'm going through and charting these players, which is a lot during the NFL playoffs or, you know, the end of college football season, I see on a lot of places that he's like a 3rd to 4th round pick. And then I go in and chart his games and he's just much, much better than that. And since then, I've heard from a pretty reliable source that some teams have round one grades on him. Maybe he's a candidate for like a team like the Steelers in the back half of the first round who've had him on a pre-draft visit. But more likely than not, I expect him to go in the second round. I would be pretty shocked if he falls to round three.
All right. So, you know, the NFL draft's coming up. Every team is going to be watching. Every player is going to be watching, you know, wanting to see what their team does. I want to know, who is the guy that if you are a super fan of an NFL team, when your team drafts this guy, you're going to go, no, they've made a mistake. I want you to make a lot of people unhappy days from now. Who is that player?
Well, with all of these guys, you know, it just depends on where they get drafted. But a player, like what round your team decides to take that tumble.
No, who's going to bust? Who's going to be terrible?
Right. One player who I don't see meeting expectations is a guy, D.D. Westbrook, who was the last player that I profiled for the Fantasy Footballers. He had the worst success rate versus press coverage score over the last 2 years at 33.3%. I don't see him as somebody that can line up on the outside and win. And even when you saw him make vertical plays at Oklahoma, it was against a lot of like Big 12 defenses. It offered him a lot of space. He didn't have high success rates on almost any route. I think he can maybe be a player that's successful like after the catch, but not only is his reception perception poor, he also has a lot of red flags in general in terms of off-field concerns. He is an older prospect. He's had some injury histories. He's also 180 pounds, less than 180 pounds. So he can easily be somebody that just doesn't hold up to the NFL level. He's someone that I would be concerned about, as well as a player like, I think if you take like Malachi Dupree from LSU, who I didn't write about for you guys, but I have in my database, and there's a reason I didn't write about him. There's just not a lot good to say. So there are some players from bigger schools that like they have bigger names. They've been on the scene for a while in this year that I think are disappointing NFL prospects. But then there are guys from smaller schools that I think you should be excited if your team takes.
Let me ask you kind of the opposite question here. And we get tons and tons of questions of people who are sitting there in their rookie drafts and saying, who do I target with this pick? And, you know, so much up to now is, okay, we got to wait and see where these guys land to determine that. Now, for you, is there a perfect marriage out there? Is there some sort of this player to this team, if it works out this way, that you're looking forward to or that you would say is the combination of NFL and fantasy success? Or is there something that you're zoning in on and saying, hey, I'd love to see this happen?
Yeah, I think Carolina has a lot of opportunity in their wide receiver core right now.
They're drafting Leonard Fournette, Matt. Everyone knows that.
Oh, God, I hope they draft Christian McCaffrey at 8th overall. If God, please. Yeah, that would be great. But I think in general, this draft is going to be really offensive focus for the Panthers because they've talked about evolving their offense, but they've done nothing to really do that in the offseason in terms of player additions. You know, they lost Ted Ginn. I think John Ross would be a fantastic fit, but I don't see him falling to the second round. And I don't see him being the pick at 8th overall. Like I said, I think they're zeroing in on McCaffrey or Leonard Fournette there. If they draft a player like a Carlos Henderson, who is great in reception perception, obviously played at a lower level of competition, but he smashed all the success rate versus coverage scores, which is what you want to see from a lower level competition player. Also was above average in contested catch conversion rate, despite being a smaller player at 76%. But really what makes him special is his ability in space. He broke multiple tackles on 39% of his in-space attempts, which I chart as plays that a player has an opportunity to break a tackle. 39% beats the second place score of 22% by miles and miles. So you can see he's just special in the open field like that. If a team like Carolina that has a lot of opportunity in the receiving core takes Carlos Henderson in the second or third round, that's great. Really any team that takes him, I think he has opportunity to get on the field right away, which if you're not a first round pick, that's just how you ingratiate yourself to a team very quickly, make yourself an asset right away and get a lot of rope at that point. So he's somebody that I think all but every team should be monitoring.
And how about Mr. Juju Smith-Schuster out of USC? There's a lot of the people on the Twitters. They want him on their fantasy teams. Are you trying to look to draft him if you're in a rookie draft?
So he's that player that I mentioned as kind of like how I felt about Tyler Boyd last year. And I wrote about this extensively in Juju Smith's evaluation for you guys was – that, you know, I don't ever pitch reception perception as like the end all be all metric. Like if a player fails in my metrics, that means he's going to be bad. I mean, I think that would be ridiculous. And I'd caution your readers against, or your listeners against, following anybody that claims that about their methodology. What reception perception does, I think, is contextualize a player's play. So much like Tyler Boyd last year, Juju Smith shows up really well on metrics that do like age adjusted production or really production heavy type of metrics, especially because he's, like I said, he's not, I don't even think he's gonna be 21 until like November of this football season. So he's a super young player, but his reception perception is really poor, much like Tyler Boyd's was last year. So I think that what that goes to show you is that it's just about, again, expectations. And I think these players, both Boyd and Juju, will be successful NFL assets, but I don't know that they have the ceilings of being like top two wide receivers in their offense, or being a player that any team should want to funnel 120 targets to. And therefore, I don't really ever see them being fantasy assets unless their teams are kind of in a tough spot and have to force opportunity their way.
All right. Zay Jones, Cooper Kupp, Ishmael Zamora, rank those three.
I mean, the best talent of all of them is Zamora, and I think it's pretty clear, but he has off-field concerns that will likely slip him to day three or out of the draft altogether, so who knows there. But if you talk about just his contested catch conversion rate is great, he's great after the catch. He's someone that could be like a Martavis Bryant that, you know, obviously is a rocky off-field persona, but great if he gets to the right spot on the third day of the NFL draft. And then I like Zay Jones a bit more than Cooper Kupp. You know, Zay Jones, I talked about him being super confusing to me because his combine was great. He's had a great pre-draft process. But at East Carolina, he was really only used on like three routes, slant, screen, digs, and curls, just short intermediate area routes. I think he's like a big slot receiver that can play a little bit of flanker, but more so is just a complementary asset. And then Cooper Kupp, I've kind of, now that I think that the tide has turned and his stock is kind of no longer out of control, I like him a little bit better as probably the guy with the best hands in the class, whether it's in contested spaces or just regular catching the pass, but also below average against press and man coverage. I think he is definitely kind of like a poor man's Jarvis Landry, Jordan Matthews type player. So take that for what you will.
All right, and we'll get you out of here on this last question. Is there a particular day three prospect that our listeners should just keep an ear out? Because, I mean, not everyone's heavily following the draft on day three, but that name that it once it goes across, perk up and see where he landed.
Yeah, I'll give you two.
Excellent.
Taywan Taylor, he might go, you know, round three, I think, but he's someone that we should be watching as a player that had a strong contested catch conversion rate despite being under 6 feet, and also was above the class average, had a top five score in this class against man coverage and also against press coverage too. So he's someone we should be paying attention to. And then a guy, Ryan Switzer out of UNC. And this one's especially pertinent for your listeners because obviously they're here for fantasy football. Switzer is much like a Jamison Crowder from a couple of years ago in the draft that he's a good player. He's just not someone that is ever going to be highly valued because he's an undersized slot receiver. But Switzer, above average against man coverage, great score against zone coverage, is much like I said with Crowder, is a slot receiver, but can win in the intermediate route. So if, much like Crowder, he goes to a team on the third day of the NFL draft, because like I said, these guys just always fall. If he goes to a team that has a high volume passing offense with a stable quarterback and a stable coaching staff, he could easily be somebody by his second year, the year that is catching 60 to 70 passes that you get at a stupid discount in your rookie draft or in redraft a few years from now. So that's someone to certainly keep in mind.
Well, we will not have much longer to speculate. We appreciate you coming on, Matt. You can find Matt on Twitter at @MattHarmon_BYB. For all the hot takes, many of them vegetable related.
Oh, those are the best.
Yeah.
Those are the best takes.
Not the most delicious takes,
no,
but the best takes.
Well, and that is a matter of opinion.
Very subjective, yeah. You should, the vegetable perception route, we won't get into that. But thank you very much for joining us, Matt. And you can read about all of these guys, and I think there's 15 full profiles on thefantasyfootballers.com. You can click on the reception perception button and get in there and dig deep into the charts and everything that Matt has broken down for us. And like we said earlier, all of his reception perception charting of the NFL top 50 wide receivers will be in the ultimate draft kit. So, Matt, thanks a lot for coming on.
Oh, my pleasure, guys. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to not only talk about these players here, but at a big platform with your guys' site. This has been an awesome partnership so far. And looking forward to the draft kit because it's going to be a lot of cool stuff for people to dig into.
It's definitely going to be a fun year. Take care. Enjoy the draft.
Thanks, fellas.
All right. Thanks to Matt Harmon, or as Mike said during one point of the interview, for no good reason, Matt Harmer.
And when we're in the interview.
Did you even notice that you?
Oh, no. Oh, no. Yeah. I noticed you two laughing in
my
face.
We were laughing hysterically.
And I had no idea what I had messed up.
Matt Harmer.
Matt Harmer. NFL.com's Matt Harmer. All right, guys. Wide receivers.
Sorry, Matt.
Exhaustive wide receiver information. Love it. You're going to get the full breakdown of all the NFL wideouts from Matt Harmon in the Ultimate Draft Kit.
Oh, yes,
the 2017
are.
Ultimate Draft Kit. But right now we're talking tight ends.
Tight ends.
Some very, very exciting tight end prospects to me.
Great draft class for tight ends. I mean, this is the best draft class in all memory. I mean, I can't remember a draft class that had several really legitimate fantasy football prospects.
So I'm just going to throw the three big names out there and let you guys talk about them because, 15 minutes doesn't go by in this office where Jason isn't watching film or talking about David Njoku. But O.J. Howard, the big name, David Njoku out of Miami, and then
– you?
Yeah, and then Evan Ingram. Evan Ingram, who's a just athletic monster. You know, O.J. Howard has the most notoriety of this group. Odd usage in Alabama, but I think everybody has seen through that usage and knows what exists with O.J. Howard. I've heard in the fantasy community all over the place, people really like envisioning Howard with different jerseys on and what he might be able to do, whether it's, you know, New York, you know, all over the place. So who's your favorite? Is it Howard, Mike?
I mean, as far as a guy that you know, this Howard's coming in the league. Howard is playing for 10 plus years. He's ridiculous. I mean, the size is unbelievable. He's 6'6", 251. He ran a 40-yard dash in 4.5 seconds at 251 pounds.
Is that not that's a Fournette beating time. Or the same time as Fournette. Identical.
but much, much heavier.
Oh, I know.
And he is
a big boy.
Absolutely outrageous. You mentioned it was unfortunate that we didn't really get to see him unleash the beast in Alabama's offense. But he's so well-rounded. So it's exciting that the ceiling exists for him to be a dominant pass-catching tight end. But you also know you have longevity here if you're looking at taking him at the back of the first round.
That, coming up that vertical number, right? The 30?
The 30-inch
vertical?
Yeah, I think so.
Whoop. So that's significantly smaller than Njoku or Ingram. Obviously, he's got the height advantage at 6'6". But
yeah, I mean, we're coming to Thursday's NFL draft, and you're going to be watching it. And if you have a team that you root for, which I assume you do, you want O.J. Howard on your NFL team. He will be a difference maker for your roster. For me, he's not my number one fantasy football tight end because while he has the talent to completely dominate, he's got great hands. Like if he goes to a team that uses him, runs him on routes, he can be, like you said, his ceiling, super high. But he's such a good blocker that it's hard to say, hey, you should just be running routes for us. You know, he needs to be helping the team. So for me, that's where I think his ceiling might be high, but my expectation is that he will not be the same fantasy football.
He only
had three touchdowns. I realized they had other weapons. Right. They didn't use him. But still, he only had three touchdowns in his entire senior year.
And seven total for 4 years.
Right. So you compare that to my guy, David Njoku. And when I watch, look, David Njoku, I think, is a fine blocker. Some people say he's not a good blocker. I think that's only because they're comparing him to O.J. Howard, who mauls guys all the way down the field. David Njoku, he's got such a great character. His story, his family, he comes from like 100 brothers and sisters that are all doctors and
That's a lot.
And scientists. It's unbelievable. So he's a smart dude. He's an athletic freak. And when I watch him run routes, he's so hard to take down after the catch. I mean, play after play, I watch him. He'll get a screen, and a guy comes and tries to tackle him. He rips his leg out and goes for a touchdown.
Rips it right out.
Rips his out of the grip, not out of the socket.
Okay. Sure. But no, I mean, either way.
I think David Njoku, I mean, if he goes to the Giants,
yeah,
I love that.
We mentioned Evan Engram, and I'm throwing in Bucky Hodges well.
Out of Virginia Tech.
These guys are off the charts athletically. Evan Engram, the comp to him is Jordan Reed, which is a tremendous comp because the guy is only 6'3", 234. That's not the normal size for a tight end.
Oh, I thought you meant like they have the same health insurance.
No.
Okay.
Their premiums are really, really high. His size is not the typical tight end. His blocking
doesn't exist. It's horrendously
bad. Call it not the best.
Yeah, you wrote down that you thought it was okay, and I just tried to see it be okay, and I could not. I mean, he's a wide receiver,
but that's how they used him. I mean, 65 receptions his senior year, and they line him up in the slot frequently, and he's running these Jordan Reed type routes where it's not just fly. He's running a dig route at 8 yards in. So he reminds me of a guy who, if you want to make him part of the focal point of the passing attack, he has that built into him. But I know when we were breaking it down, Jason, you preferred Bucky.
Yeah. I mean, if I was an NFL franchise, I would be grabbing Bucky Hodges over Evan Engram. I think he had everything except for the speed that Evan Engram had. He's a little bit more raw, but he also has, I mean, Bucky Hodges is 6'6", 257, and I think can develop into a good blocker, and he was great downfield, and he runs the same type of routes, so I like Bucky Hodges more than Evan Engram.
Bucky Hodges, my favorite part of his tape is when they line him up outside and he just becomes a downfield blocker.
Oh!
Because they put him on these DBs.
The little tiny corners.
And he's 257. So, I mean, he's
not a good feeling if you're a little DB.
He takes him out of the back of the end zone. He's like running him into the hall down, just blocking them forever.
It's very fun to watch.
My favorite part of him is his name, though. I mean, Bucky Hodges, that's an NFL tight end name for a decade.
Yeah, just like Jake Butt.
Quarterbacks.
We are adults.
No, we're not. Someone gave us a 3-star iTunes review because of the voice of public opinion.
Oh. But you make me sad.
Yeah, they said it's a 5-star show, but the voice of public opinion was annoying.
Oh, man. I'm sorry.
I found that offensive.
I find it highly accurate.
All right, let's talk quarterbacks, guys. I've got some strong opinions at the quarterback position. I know, look, every year, it doesn't really matter how good the quarterbacks are. They're going to go in the first round. There's going to be a few because the NFL teams are desperate for quarterback play, and we understand that. We've seen it year over year. You see how high guys like Christian Ponder and Blaine Gabbert go.
Christian Ponder.
Look, the names. E.J. Manuel. I mean,
Jamarcus.
Yeah, I mean, this is a tradition, right? You're going to have some flops at the quarterback position. The question this year when we dig in is, look, we're a fantasy football show. So for one, is there a guy that can come out, establish themselves over the first couple of years and become a player? I mean, look, last year Carson Wentz, by all intents and purposes, great year.
Bad, not a good fantasy year.
No,
though.
No, really my point is that
gotcha.
Great year. Met expectations or exceeded them from a team perspective, from a fantasy perspective. We're hoping that happens this year.
Yeah.
We're hoping that with the weapons and with the evolution of the player, it happens this year. You had a year where 1-2 went Jameis Winston and Marcus Mariota. They weren't reliable fantasy options that year.
Since 2000, Carson Wentz had the seventh best rookie fantasy season. So, like, you can't ask for more than that, and it was still irrelevant for fantasy. So none of these guys are anywhere near as good as Carson Wentz, in my opinion, of the four major guys. And, you know, if you're talking about this year, forget about it. No one's coming in and helping your franchise this year, in my opinion.
So, I, look, we can be here and we can pretend to be, you know, scouting experts.
We're not.
But I think that the best goal here is to say, is there any of these guys that we believe could develop into, and I'm not even going to go as far as just say Carson Wentz. I'm going to say, can these guys develop on a roster into a 10-year starter, into an Andy Dalton, Phillip Rivers, even an Andrew Luck type of guy? Now, the guys I want to bring up are the potential first-round guys, Mitchell Trubisky, Deshaun Watson, Patrick Mahomes, and then Deshaun Kaiser. Those are the big names. Now, you can throw Davis Webb in there if you want as well. He transferred out of Texas Tech where Mahomes was and went to California and really put up impressive numbers in his final season there in the Pac-12. For me, I like Mitch Trubisky. I think Trubisky is the most NFL-ready quarterback. I love the size. I love the accuracy. I love the smarts. And I think when you see a player, there's two sides to the one-year starter argument. There is the not enough experience, so it gives a coach hesitation. There's also the room to grow argument, because what is this guy and what can he become with even more experience? He had such an impressive year at North Carolina. What I love is that 30-6 TD to interception ratio. I don't want this guy coming in. That's my concern with a guy like Mahomes, who I think has incredible arm talent, but is he going to throw 18, 19, 20 interceptions?
And Watson, who's high levels of interceptions.
Yeah, I mean,
so for me, if I were to rank them, it'd be Trubisky, and then I think I would take the chance on Mahomes, then I'd go Kaiser, and then I'd go Watson to round out my four, and now I'll just pass the mic.
Sure. For me, Kaiser would be my number one. I think he has the best combination of potential and level-headed maturity, because, you know, Mahomes has the highest potential, right? It seems like these four guys, you kind of have sliding scales, right? Like Deshaun Watson has the least upside potential, but the lowest floor. Mahomes is, I mean,
he could have the most potential. I don't know if that's a kind of a...
His arm is unbelievable.
Yeah.
His physical traits are things that make, you know, NFL GMs drool. But I don't think that he has the experience, the level-headed mind of an NFL quarterback to succeed. Whereas when I look at Kaiser, I mean, you talk about the 1 year, right? If Kaiser had come out after 2015, he might have been a top two pick or three with, you know, after Wentz. Kaiser, there's plenty of knocks on him, right? There was a chance that he didn't want to keep playing football. And when I'm a GM, all I care about for my NFL quarterback is, like, I don't want them to have a girlfriend. I want them to be married to football. And so that's a big red flag.
Dude, you're mean.
I don't love anyone in this class, but what I see with Kaiser is a strong arm, can make every throw, huge body, and a level-headed mind. I think he's got everything I need to say, you want a future Andy Dalton. Kaiser's my pick.
Yeah, Kaiser's also my favorite quarterback of these guys. What's interesting for quarterbacks is it's so hard to scout guys to who's going to translate to be a good NFL quarterback, because it's not like a running back or wide receiver where you can look at these, how do they do at the combine, how athletic are they, and that can really help factor into, you know, who's going to be able to separate at the NFL level. Meanwhile, you have guys like Mahomes, senior year, put up over 5,000 passing yards.
Dude, he had a game over 800 yards.
I mean, and you have Kaiser, who was never above 3. I mean, you have completely different offenses.
There, 700, but yeah.
It was 800 total.
I thought you were saying passing yards. Yeah.
So it's just very, very difficult. But of what I've seen, I like Jason pretty much made all my points of Kaiser's my favorite guy of this group.
You guys have read the Parcells rules for quarterbacks before? Have you guys either of you read that?
I don't think I have. Give them to me.
He's come out and he's talked about this before, about what he looks for in a quarterback. And so for him, it was he must be a senior, because you need time and maturity to develop into a good professional quarterback. He needs to be a graduate, somebody who takes his responsibilities seriously. Maybe that's a little, you know, get off my lawn, old school. 3-year starter. You need to make sure his success wasn't basically a one-time thing.
But he
was the guy for a period of time.
If the next one is throws slowly, then you've got a home run here. You're describing Deshaun Watson.
He must have at least 23 wins because big passing numbers, like Mahomes, must come in the context of winning ball games. That is now it's interesting when you look at those.
Man, college has changed so
you
much
look at,
since.
There are, you know, Romo, Manning, Breeze, Wilson, Rivers, Palmer, and then Eli Manning. Those were 4-for-4 on those points for the Parcells things. But you have had guys like Cam Newton, who was only a 1-of-4 of those.
Seems like
Aaron Rodgers was only 2-of-4 of those. But
Deshaun Watson fits all four, right?
No, he's not a senior.
Oh, okay. He graduated
because
as
he graduated
a junior.
Early. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But
and,
he did. He was a 3-year starter.
Right.
Right. So,
or no,
know,
two.
I think people, if they're listening, we need to wrap it up before we get out of here and then get to the draft on Thursday and the draft show. But
get those sleeps in.
Get those sleeps started. You know, I think people are surprised maybe that Deshaun Watson's name didn't come up more in this conversation. And I think that's just when you look at Deshaun Watson and you look at Mitch Trubisky, you see the exact inverse of kind of how the college game and the NFL game works. And you saw this with Tim Tebow, Heisman winner. Now, Watson didn't win the Heisman, but he was twice a finalist, was a winner, was great. And I'm not taking anything away from the person or player of Deshaun Watson as a collegiate athlete. But you contrast him with a guy like Mitchell Trubisky, who plays 13 games, only one season in North Carolina, but has all the physical tools that translate to the pros. And you see the, you know, teams, you know, Trubisky's going to get drafted before Deshaun Watson. And the odds of Deshaun Watson being successful in the NFL seem a lot lower to me than Trubisky. So
it's
unfortunate that that's the way it works, but, it's
hard to find metrics on these guys. And this, Matt Kelly was talking about this from Roto Underworld. He was saying that throw velocity, which is – you can track that. That's an easily trackable stat. Deshaun Watson maxed out this season at 49. And there's no – not nobody. There's, in the NFL, guys who throw under 50. Tyrod Taylor, Mike Glennon. Those are the two starting quarterbacks who their velocity is not over 50 miles an hour. So there is not a great track record of guys. I mean, it sounds ridiculous – like, well, 49 or 51. But when you're throwing an out route, that is a major difference for a defender to be able to jump that route.
Yeah, and the distance the ball travels, we read an article on that. It's just it's night and day. And then you combine that with his accuracy problems where he doesn't have accuracy mistakes that are all repeated. It's not constantly overthrowing guys or constantly underthrowing. It's just kind of sometimes is right on point, sometimes is behind, sometimes is ahead. Those are scary things for me when I look at college quarterbacks. I want an accurate guy, not a Logan Thomas.
The tight end?
The now tight end.
All right, that does it for today's show. Hopefully you've got these names in your head. You're ready for the draft.
Get hyped!
We'll get you some more draft and team previews on Thursday, as well as some mailbag from the Foot Clan. And all the news and notes, anything we missed, anything we didn't get over the weekend, recording this show a couple days early. So,
and our live stream is coming up on Thursday as well, right before the draft.
Oh, my gosh.
For the Join the Footers. Gosh.
I guess I like football. Mike, have a good trip.
Thank you. And check out FantasyJocks.com. If you want to pick up a trophy, the promo code is FOOTBALLERS. Hey-oh.
Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter @TheFFBallers.